Lupin Pharmaceuticals in association with Higher Secondary Principals Forum.
Hello students, every day right from morning till night we use chemicals and principles of chemicals to control our activities. For example, toothpaste as cleansing agent, soaps also as cleansing agent, housing materials which are used, cement, concrete, electronic materials what we use, different dyes when you think of, you have got clothes which we are wearing. When we think of sickness, it's all the medicines which come to our help. We have also have explosive fuels, rocket propellants, which use a lot of chemicals. When we think about our food, we have coloring agents, we have minerals, vitamins, which are added to food substance. We also have other material polymers like nylon, ropes, PVC pipes, and our body itself has got so many chemicals, macromolecules, which have got chemistry present inside. So all activities are controlled by chemistry and principles of chemistry. We are going to focus on only three items, that is drugs, food, and cleansing agents. Drugs, these are chemicals of very low molecular mass, ranging from 100 to 500 units or unified mass, as you say, or we say gram, 100 to 500 gram per mole. These drugs, they interact with macromolecular targets, for example, enzymes, carbohydrate, fats, and they produce biological response of well-being. A pharmaceutical drug is called a drug or a medicine if that chemical can treat, prevent, cure, or diagnose a disease. Use of chemicals for therapeutic use or therapeutic effect. When we say therapeutic use or effect, means it induces cells' sense of well-being. It cures body and mind. That is called therapeutic effect. It is called chemotherapy. In order to understand how these drugs interact with our body, we have to see this enzyme-substrate interaction. As you all know, enzymes are present throughout our body. These enzymes, they interact in such a way which we call lock and key mechanism. For example, we have maltose in our body which is converted to glucose with the help of enzyme called maltase. This is the enzyme, maltase. Enzyme which is blue, which is maltase, and the one which is in red, that is maltose molecule. The enzyme has got two important functions. It has this active sites, these points what you see, okay, these are active sites where the substrate, that is your maltose molecule, will come and adhere itself. So enzyme helps to hold the molecule, that is a substrate, and then this active sites, they have got functional groups in them. With the help of these functional groups, glucose molecules are formed from maltose. This molecule is converted into 2 moles of glucose. This is our normal enzyme. Enzyme plus substrate. When drugs interferes with these enzymes, they compete for this substrate. The one which is in green in color is your substrate. Your drug is blue in color. So drug comes and competes with this substrate and bind itself to the enzyme. Another way drug can function is, drug will not attack this active site, but it will attack another site called allosteric site, and then the active site will be changed. Now the substrate cannot identify this enzyme, so it does not link to this enzyme. Another way how drugs can interfere with our body is through the cell membrane. Our cell membrane have got protein molecules, blue colored ones. These protein molecules are embedded in our cell membrane. In the cell membrane, you find these receptor proteins. These are embedded in the cell wall. This project out here and provides its active site for the binding molecule. The binding molecule which is going to come, it is also called chemical messenger. This is a receptor in the cell wall. To this, the binding molecule which is going to come, it is also called chemical messenger or hormone or neurotransmitter, or drug can come and interact with this receptor molecule, and it will produce a biological response and it will induce a sense of well-being. How do drugs work? Drugs works in two ways: antagonist as antagonist or agonist. When we say antagonist, they bind to the receptor site and inhibits its natural action, whereas agonist, they mimic the natural messenger. As you see in earlier slide here, so drug is mimicking here. Instead of chemical messenger, drug is come, that's called mimic. Mimic the natural messenger. Or it can directly bind to the receptor site. Next, agonists are important when we don't want the message to be produced by the body. So when we don't want that message to go to the body, that is sickness and all, so that time we drugs called antagonists are used. The agonists are useful when there is lack of, when your body is lacking natural messengers. There are no natural messengers in our body, so that time drugs are given. Based on therapeutic action, we have different classes of drugs. One, antacids, antihistamines, neurological active drugs. They are classified into tranquilizers and analgesic. Next, antimicrobials, which are also divided into antibiotics, antiseptics, and disinfectant. And last, antifertility drugs. When we talk about antacids, these are used against acidity. Acidity is produced due to use of excess of oily food substances, tea. All these substances will produce acidity in our stomach. Acidity is nothing but we described it as overproduction of acid in stomach, which will cause inflammation and pain. Sometimes we also get heartburns. Acid produced in the stomach rises up to the chest and then it comes near the throat. And we also call it as acid reflux. Until 1970, sodium bicarbonate was used along with mixture of aluminium and magnesium hydroxide. But it was found that excess of this sodium bicarbonate will make our stomach alkaline and make our stomach, that is trigger stomach, to produce more acidity. Metal hydroxides are said to produce or raise the pH above neutrality and are insoluble. Next, we have antihistamines. The discovery of antihistamine took place while treating hyperacidity. A chemical called histamine was seen to produce pepsin, secrete pepsin, and hydrochloric acid. Histamine also is also a potent vasodilator. It contracts the smooth muscles in bronchi and gut and relaxes the other muscles. It is also responsible for nasal congestion associated with cold and allergic response to pollens, dust, fishes, fruits, eggs, Cadbury's, etc. There are different types of allergies, like allergy towards all these food substances, towards sun, and the reactions produced are we get itchy eyes, people are found to be sneezing, coughing, wheezing sound, runny nose, sometimes hay fever, sore throat, rashes on the skin, swelling of the skin, etc. So these are the allergic reactions what we see due to secretion of histamine, over secretion of histamine. Cimetidine and ranitidine, these were used to treat hyperacidity because they were preventing the interaction of histamine with the receptors. Now, as we have already seen receptors earlier, they are either your enzymes or proteins molecules embedded in the cell membrane. Cimetidine was used for a very long time until ranitidine came into existence, also called Zantac. This was found to be 8 times more potent, powerful than cimetidine. The other synthetic drugs which came into existence were bromopheniramine called dimetap and terephenidine, seldin. They work as antagonists which bind and block histamine with binding site of receptor cells. So here you see how the drugs are going to, histamines are going to, this is how they are going to bind with the, instead of histamine, these drugs are going to, this is like your histamine and this is your binding molecule, that is your drug. And this, they are going to block histamine from interacting with the receptor cell, just now what we said. Next class of drugs we have, neurologically active drugs. These are divided into two types, tranquilizers and analgesics. Tranquilizers, this affect messenger transfer mechanism from nerve to the receptor, whereas analgesic, they are simply called painkillers, or we say they reduce or abolish pain without causing impairment of consciousness, mental confusion, incoordination or paralysis or any other mental disturbances. This affect the nervous system, tranquilizers, analgesic do not affect our nervous system. We have tranquilizers now in detail, chemicals which relieve stress, anxiety, irritability, excitement and induce sense of well-being. Person who is very nervous, undergoing depression, he will find relief by relieving his stress, anxiety, irritability and excitement. And he'll feel sleepy. After getting up from sleep, the person feels very normal. Tranquilizers are further divided into three types, antidepressant drugs, mild tranquilizer and barbiturates. Antidepressant drugs are iproniazid, phenazine, Iquanil, which are used to treat depression and hypertension. Mild tranquilizers, they are also treating depression and hypertension. Chlorodiepoxide, meprobamate. Barbiturates are veranal, amital, secanal, nembutal and luminal. Besides, we also have very mild tranquilizers, valium and serotonin. How these tranquilizers function? As antidepressants, our brain is secreting a chemical called noradrenaline. Now, this is a neurotransmitter which shifts our moods. If body is secreting very less amount of adrenaline, then it will send less signals to our body and then the person is said to suffer from depression. Antidepressant drugs, when they are taken, what they will do is, they will stop those enzymes which are responsible for destroying adrenaline. So if those enzymes are tackled by the drugs, then they will be called antidepressant drugs. Whereas barbiturates, these are sedatives, or hypnotics as we call, they produce sleep, so they are sleep producing drugs. Here you see the neurotransmitter, purple in color, which binds to the receptor here of the other nerve. These are two nerves, so from neuron to neurons the nerve impulse is sent. Neurotransmitters, if there they are released less, then the signals will not be sent. The next class we have is analgesics. Analgesics are divided into two types,
non-narcotics and narcotics. Non-narcotics means they are non-addictive. The person does not get addicted to this drugs. Whereas narcotics, most have heard about anti-narcotic day. On anti-narcotic day, especially, it is against the use of narcotics. Narcotics like heroin, morphine, codeine, these are narcotics. They are habit forming. So if they are consumed, then they will form habits, so addictives. Analgesics are also called painkillers, and they do not affect central nervous system. These are non-narcotic in nature. Two non-narcotics which are there, aspirin and paracetamol. Aspirin is also called acetyl salicylic acid. It's a chemical name for aspirin. It stops inflammation and pains in tissues and therefore can be used in the treatment of arthritis. This also reduces fever. The substances which reduces fever, they are called antipyretic. They also prevent platelet coagulation and also serve as an anti-blood clotting agents, or shows anti-blood clotting action, therefore helps in prevention of heart attack. The second, under analgesic, the second class is narcotics. These are addictive or habit-forming drugs. Narcotics like morphine, heroin, codeine, they are also referred to as opiates because they are obtained from opium seeds. This is khaskhas, as you already use in your kitchen. Effects of this narcotics are they relieve pain and produce sleep. But the excess dose of this narcotics, it produces stupor, that is unconscious, coma, person can go in coma, convulsions, sudden violent epilepsy like symptoms, and it can also produce untimely death. They are essentially, sometimes they are used in post-operative treatment or cancer pain. The next class of drugs what we have are antimicrobials. These are responsible for almost all the diseases in human being. We have microorganisms like virus, bacteria, fungi, parasites. Parasites are like malarial parasites. Virus, as you all know, this is very common nowadays, coronavirus. They require a host. Once they get a host, they develop inside the body of the host, sometimes killing the host. Examples are diseases like common cold, influenza. These are affected by viruses. Bacteria, Salmonella bacteria, which is in the stomach, cause irritation. Fungi, on the bread and all, you see fungi developing molds. As per the type of microorganisms, we have the drugs. For bacteria, we have antibacterial drug. For fungi, we have antifungal drug. For virus, we have antiviral drug. For parasite, we have antiparasitic drugs. All this together would be called as antibiotics or antiseptic disinfectant. Antibiotics produce very low toxicity towards human beings and animals. Antibiotics are the chemical substances produced by fungi, bacteria, or molds. They are extracted from microorganisms and they produce very low toxicity towards humans and animals. Now we find the definition of this antibiotics is changed to this because with the revolution of chemicals, chemical methods were developed, synthetic compounds were prepared, and these synthetic compounds, they were prepared same like those found in the microorganisms, and they were found to be very effective, okay, as compared to the previous chemicals. So the change definition is substance produced partly or wholly by chemical synthesis which in low concentration destroys or stops the growth of microorganism by intervening their metabolic activities. They will interfere with the metabolic activity of the microorganisms and they will stop their growth, or sometimes they may kill those microorganisms. German bacteriologist Paul Hellrich, he studied a arsenic-based structured compound and he used it for the treatment of syphilis. And the compound was named as arsephenamine or sulvarsine. This was found to be toxic, no doubt, to human being, but its toxicity to the bacteria, spirochete, was more than that shown on human beings, for which he was awarded Nobel Prize in the year 1908. He observed that the linkage which is present in arsephenamine, AS, double bond AS, that linkage was similar to azodice. And these compounds, they were also showing colored effect on the tissues. Here, these are the drugs. This is arsephenamine, AS, double bond AS, and that's another azo dye which is having N double bond N. So the structure he found to be very similar. So he started doing research on more of this particular compounds so that they will interact with the bacteria and kill its action. In 1932, he found first antibacterial drug based on chemical synthesis called prontosil. When prontosil was taken in the body, it got converted into an active compound, sulfanilamide. The activity was shown actually by this. So this led to the discovery of sulfur drugs. The most among the sulfur drugs, the most effective is sulfapyridine. There was another big revolution simultaneously taking place, that is in the year 1929, Sir Alexander Fleming, he extracted drug called penicillin from fungus Penicillium. The antibiotics are also divided into, based on their action, they are divided into two types, that is cidal or static. Cidal means killings and static means stopping, that is inhibitory. Bactericidal drugs are penicillin, aminoglycosides, and ofloxacin. Bacteriostatic drugs are erythromycin, tetracycline, chloramphenicol. Based on the staining effect, the bacteria were shown to be two types. Gram-positive bacteria, that is bacteria which show positive test for gram staining test, and gram-negative bacteria, bacteria which show negative test for gram staining test. Now, based on the range of bacteria which are going to affect the microorganisms, again we have classification: broad spectrum antibiotic, narrow spectrum antibiotic, and limited spectrum antibiotic. Broad spectrum antibiotic was found to stain gram positive and gram negative bacteria. Example: ampicillin, amoxicillin, vancomycin, ofloxacin. These are the drugs. Plus this chloramphenicol is been used widely for typhoid, dysentery, acute fever, urinary infection, meningitis, and pneumonia. Whereas narrow spectrum antibiotic will stain either gram positive or gram negative. Example, penicillin G. The third type what we have is limited spectrum antibiotic, which is effective against a single organism. Dicyrine is used for treatment of cancer, some types of cancer. The next class of antimicrobials we have, antiseptic and disinfectants. Both will kill or prevent the growth of microorganism, but they differ in their action of application. Antiseptics can be applied on the living tissues, Whereas disinfectant will be applied to inanimated objects, meaning in toilet, bathroom, floors. There you can use this disinfectant. So disinfectant apply to inanimated objects such as floor, drainage systems, instruments. Antiseptic can be applied to living tissues such as wounds, cuts, disease, skin. Examples of antiseptics used: furosemide, sofromycin, Dettol, which is a mixture of chlorzoxanol and terpineol, bithionol. This is an antiseptic present in soap. Sometimes you will be asked, name the antiseptic present in the soap. Then you have iodine in alcohol and water, which we also call tincture iodine. We have iodoform, which is used for pets. Then we have aqueous dilute boric acid solution, which can be used in the treatment of eyes. Now we have the next class, chemicals which are used in food. We have finished with drugs. Now we have chemicals which can be used for food. Why do we use chemicals for food? To give a nice appeal, for preservation, to add nutritive value to our food. Food additives are food colors, flavors, sweeteners, fat emulsifiers, stabilizing agents, flour improvers, antioxidants, preservatives, nutritional supplements, vitamins, amino acids, and minerals. Now we have a big class of artificial sweeteners. Artificial sweeteners are natural as well as chemical. Natural sweeteners, some like sugar, will add to calories. So in order to avoid that, we have saccharin as a chemical based sweetener. This was found in 1879. It is also called orthosulfobenzamide. This is found to be 550 times sweet than normal sugar. This can be safely used by diabetic people because this is easily excreted out through urine. Next we have aspartame. It is a combination of aspartic acid and phenylalanine. This is 100 times as sweet as sugar. But this is unstable at cooking temperature, means we cannot use it while cooking. It is limited to soft drinks and cold foods. So this can be safely used for soft drinks. Next we have allitame, high potency sweetener. Its sweetness is so high, cannot be controlled. Sucralose, trichloro derivative of sucrose. This is can be used at cooking temperature, stable at cooking temperature. This does not add to the calories. Food preservatives we are using in order to prevent spoilage of food due to microbial growth. You find that pickles, okay, have got lot of food preservatives. Salts which are used for preservation, like preserving fish, sugars are used, vegetable oil, sodium benzoate, salts of sorbic and propionic acid. These are the examples of some food preservatives. Now we have the third class of chemicals which are used as cleansing agents, that is soaps and synthetic detergents. Soaps are prepared from oil and the process is called saponification. If you take oil treated with NaOH, okay, you will find you will get glycerol and soap. Soap is a sodium salt of fatty acid. This R3, which is written R1, R2, R3, these are high fatty acid molecules. Like R can be here C17H35, stearic acid. R is C17H35COOH. So if R is C17H35COOH, this one will be called sodium stearate. So this we can use stearic acid, palmitic acid, oleic acid. These fatty acids can be used to prepare soap. By adding sodium chloride, you can precipitate the soap and glycerol will be left behind. The types of soaps are toilet soaps, which have better grade of fats and oils. Colors are used, perfumes are also used. Therefore, we find them having better appearance and can be safely used for our body. Soaps that float. These are obtained by beating tiny air bubbles before they are hardened. Okay, and so they float. Therefore, they are called soaps that float. Next, we have transparent soap. These are obtained by dissolving in ethanol and then evaporating. Medicated soaps, we use tulsi, pudina, this type of substances are used in order to prepare these soaps. Shaving soaps, in this there is glycerol which is added, which will prevent drying, and sodium resonate is also used, which will produce lather. Next, we have laundry soaps, which contains sodium resonate, carbonate, silicate, and borax. Soap granules, these are small dried miniature soaps, so dried miniature soap bubbles. Soap powders or scouring soaps, they contain scouring agents like powdered pumice, sand builders like sodium bicarbonate, sodium trisodium phosphate. Soap chips, these are made by running thin sheets of melted soap into cool cylinders and then scraping off into small pieces. Why soaps do not work in hard water? Hard water contains calcium and magnesium ions, so it will interact with it and will not produce lather. Here this is hard water in which soap has not produced any lather. Here this is soft water in which soap has produced lather. You find that hair washed with hard water, they look very dull. Even clothes which are used for dyeing purpose, they will not absorb dyes if the clothes are washed in hard water. Soap when interacts with hard water, so hard water contains calcium chloride. Soap when interacts with hard water will produce, the calcium will come in place of sodium, so you will get calcium stearate. This is stearic sodium stearate. Calcium stearate will be produced, and this will be like another soap, and it will remain insoluble. And this another soap will form scum. It is also called scum. So insoluble soap, which is a scum, this makes your soap unfit for as a cleansing agent. It also remains attached or adheres to the fabric as a gummy mass. Now we have synthetic detergents. You must be using all these, most of these detergents like Fena, Ariel, Ghadi, all these detergents, they are different as compared to soap. They are just like soap, but they are not soaps. Synthetic detergents are cleansing agents. They are having properties of soap, okay, but they do not contain any soap. They can be used as opposite to that of soaps. They can be used. This can be used both in soft and hard water. We have classification of detergents based on the structure. First one, cationic detergents. These are quaternary ammonium salts of amines with acetate bromide as anion. Now this is nothing but ammonium derivative, just like NH4+, N, H, 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 NH4+. So it's called quaternary ammonium salt. Quaternary because derivative of amines. N is having plus sign here, and this anion remains outside. This can be bromide, fluoride, acetate. These find used in hair conditioners. Next class we have anionic detergents. These are sodium salts of sulfonated long chain of alcohols. Now these reactions are not there for y'all, but you just have to know what is the meaning of this anionic detergents and where they are used. So these have got long chain. For example, here lauryl alcohol has got total 12 carbons. Okay, and when it is treated with sulfuric acid, you get lauryl hydrogen sulfate, which when treated with sodium hydroxide produces sodium lauryl sulfate. Anion is a very big part here, and cation is only one small part, that is sodium. Therefore, it is called anionic. Same way, we have dodecyl benzene. This is a hydrocarbon. Alcohols or this is alcohol. We had finished. Now hydrocarbon. Hydrocarbon dodecyl benzene, when treated with sulfuric acid, will give you dodecyl benzene sulfonic acid. This, when treated with base, you will get in place of H, Na will come, and you will get sodium dodecyl benzene sulfonate. So these are two anionic detergents which are having big anion part and a small cation, therefore anionic detergents. Third type we have, non-ionic detergents. They do not contain any ion. They neither contain cation nor contain any anion. This non-ionic detergents, they are prepared from, this is stearic acid and this is ethylene glycol. So they will give you a non-anionic detergent. It doesn't have any anion. This act as a soap. They also forms micelle. They also remove dirt and grease, just like soap. They are used in liquid dishwashing detergents. Now there are some dangers which are posed by detergents. Detergents having branched hydrocarbons are found to be more dangerous than detergents having straight chain hydrocarbon. These detergents cannot be degraded by bacteria, and the effluents means the waste chemicals from industries or the waste from the public houses. These containing detergents, after reaching ponds and rivers, remains there even if the sewage is treated, and this leads to pollution causing foaming. This happened in Bangalore, and this is Yamuna River. As you see here, there is foaming due to overuse of detergents. So we have seen three class of compounds, that is drugs, food, and chemical cleansing agents, chemicals used in cleansing agents.
Prudent Scholars, powered by Lupin Pharmaceuticals.